Hi everybody. We've spent the three previous videos covering our first model system in quantum mechanics, the particle in a box. The particle in a box was simple enough that even with our limited background in differential equations, we were able to exactly find the mathematical form of the wave functions and the energies. In this video, we'll move on to our next model system, the quantum harmonic oscillator. And it turns out we're not really in a position to solve the math as completely in this case. But we'll do our best to set up the equations and to look qualitatively at the answers, to see some features that are similar and some features that are different from the particle in a box. So what exactly is the quantum harmonic oscillator? It's the one-dimensional environment in which we want to solve the Schrödinger equation for a potential energy operator V of x that is parabolic. We define the potential energy operator as 1/2 kx squared, where k is some constant. As you can see in the picture, the potential energy is an upward opening parabola centered at x equals 0. So why are we doing this? How is this relevant to chemistry? Well, the hint comes in the fact that you may recognize that potential energy operator, 1/2 kx squared, as the potential energy of a Hooke's law spring. By applying the classical potential energy of a spring to the Schrödinger equation, we're essentially looking at how a really small particle on a really small spring behaves when viewed through the lens of quantum mechanics. So what we're finding when we solve the Schrödinger equation for this system are the energy levels of a vibrating diatomic molecule. And this is relevant especially to vibrational spectroscopy, or infrared spectroscopy. What this means is that the particle in a box and the quantum harmonic oscillator are focusing on two different types of motion of atoms and molecules. Remember that the particle in a box focuses on translational motion, the motion of an atom moving around a container or an electron moving around inside a molecule. But the harmonic oscillator is focused on vibrations, the vibrational energies of a diatomic molecule as the two atoms vibrate back and forth as if they're attached by a spring. But even though the harmonic oscillator and particle in a box models apply to different types of motion, they have some significant similarities also. This picture shows the potential energy operators for the two systems, with the harmonic oscillator on the left and the particle in a box on the right. In a sense, both systems are just potential energy wells, where the potential energy at the center is low and the potential energy on the sides goes to infinity. So even though the shapes are different, we expect the wave functions for these two systems to have some similarities. For one thing, we know that as you go to the sides, as the potential energy goes to infinity, the wave functions in both systems have to go to zero, or else the energy of the wave function would be infinite. Also, we expect the wave functions near the center to be oscillating and to have nodes. In the same way the particle in a box wave functions each had a different number of nodes, and their energies increased with increasing number of nodes, we expect something similar for the harmonic oscillator. And also, the fact that the potential energy goes to infinity on both sides provides boundary conditions that cause the energies of the wave functions to be quantized for both of these systems. Before actually looking at equations for the wave functions and the energies, let's look at a picture of what the harmonic oscillator wave functions look like. You can see that all of these wave functions have the features that we expect. First of all, the wave functions go to zero on both sides as the potential energy goes to infinity. Also, the wave functions are oscillating near the center with different numbers of nodes. And finally, the energies are quantized, with energies increasing as the number of nodes increases. The main difference between these harmonic oscillator wave functions and the corresponding particle in a box wave functions is that the harmonic oscillator wave functions don't go to zero as abruptly on the sides, because the potential energy operator doesn't go as abruptly to infinity on the sides. I'd like to take a minute to point out that the way the vertical axis is used in figures like this is kind of confusing. The vertical axis is intended to represent energy. The potential energy operator gets higher in energy as you move away from the center, and the height of each of these wave functions represents the fact that wave functions with more nodes are higher in energy. But the fact that each wave function oscillates up and down doesn't mean that the energy of each wave function is getting higher or lower. It just means that the value of the wave function is getting higher or lower. So in a sense, this vertical axis is actually being used for two different things. It's mostly being used for energy, but within each wave function, it's being used for the value of the wave function. So be careful of that confusion. Now we're ready to look at the mathematical form of the wave functions and the energies of a harmonic oscillator, even if we can't really solve the Schrödinger equation completely. The form of the wave functions is shown in the equation at the top of this slide. You can see it consists of a few terms multiplied together. A normalization constant, n, a polynomial, capital H, which we'll get to in a second, and a Gaussian function, e to the negative alpha x squared over 2, where alpha is a collection of constants involving the mass of the particle and the spring constant k. Let's look first at the polynomial term, capital H. These are a set of polynomials well known to mathematicians. They're called the Hermite polynomials, and they're shown in the table. Each polynomial corresponds to a value of v, where v can have any integer value from 0 to infinity. Each polynomial has order v, and by that I mean v equals 0 is a constant, v equals 1 is a line, v equals 2 is a parabola, etc. So these polynomials oscillate, and as v increases, the functions cross through 0 an increasing number of times. In other words, they have an increasing number of nodes. Specifically, each polynomial has v nodes. When v equals 0, the polynomial never crosses through 0. When v equals 1, the polynomial crosses through 0 once, etc. So we've accounted for the nodes in our harmonic oscillator wave functions, but we still haven't accounted for the fact that they go to 0 as you move far to the left or far to the right. That's where the Gaussian term comes in. As you may know, a Gaussian function is basically a bell curve that decays exponentially as you move far to the left or to the right. If you think about what happens to the function e to the negative alpha x squared over 2 as x gets very negative or very positive, the exponent gets very negative, and e to a very negative number gets closer and closer to 0. So it's this Gaussian part of the wave function that causes the wave function to go to 0 far to the left or to the right. As I mentioned, we weren't really in a position to solve the Schrödinger equation exactly for the harmonic oscillator. But I do want to emphasize that even though we couldn't solve for the wave functions, we can confirm fairly easily that they are solutions to the Schrödinger equation. If you want to confirm that any one of these wave functions corresponding to a different value of v is actually a solution to the Schrödinger equation, you can just plug it in and show that it's an energy eigenfunction. If you were to solve for the energies of those wave functions, you would hopefully find something like the equation on this slide. The energies corresponding to a value of v are equal to v plus 1/2 times h bar times the square root of k over m, where k is the spring constant from the potential energy operator, and m is the mass of the particle. Sometimes this is also written more concisely as v plus 1/2 times h bar times omega, where omega is the frequency of a classical Hooke's law spring. There are a few things that I'd like to point out about these energies. First, the energies of a harmonic oscillator are equally spaced. If you plug in the values v equals 0, 1, 2, etc., you'll notice that from one wave function to the next, the energy always increases by h bar times the square root of k over m. This equal spacing of energies in the harmonic oscillator is different from the particle in a box. Remember, for the particle in a box, energies were proportional to the quantum number n squared, so they got farther apart as n increased. Another difference from the particle in a box that's worth noticing is that for the harmonic oscillator, the quantum number v starts at 0. The lowest energy wave function for the harmonic oscillator corresponds to v equals 0, whereas the lowest energy wave function for the particle in a box corresponded to n equals 1. One thing that is similar between the two models is that, like the particle in a box, the ground state of the harmonic oscillator has a zero-point energy. What that means is that the lowest energy wave function, in this case corresponding to v equals 0, does not have an energy of 0. In other words, even the lowest energy state of a vibrating diatomic molecule has some energy. In the harmonic oscillator wave functions and energies that we've solved for, there's still one variable that I've been a little bit vague about the meaning of, and that's the mass m. Strictly speaking, the harmonic oscillator system that we've solved for is the case of one particle of mass m attached by a spring to something stationary, like a wall. But more often than not, chemists aren't interested in one particle vibrating against a wall. They're interested in a diatomic molecule, where two objects are pushing and pulling on each other. So in a diatomic molecule, what mass is it that we should be concerned about? The total mass of the molecule? The mass of one of the atoms? Or something else? We're not going to go through all of the math here, but it turns out that for a diatomic molecule, the mass that's most relevant to us is what's called the effective mass, or the reduced mass, which allows us to treat a two-body system as one object in terms of one internal coordinate. For a two-body system of masses m1 and m2, the effective mass, which is symbolized by the Greek letter mu, is defined as the product of the two masses over the sum of the two masses. So in our expressions for the harmonic oscillator wave functions and energies, rather than m, it's really mu that we're concerned about. Think about what happens to this expression for mu if the two masses m1 and m2 are very different from each other, for example in a molecule like HI. If that's the case, the denominator, m1 plus m2, is dominated by the larger mass, which means the effective mass approaches the smaller mass. So in a molecule like HI, the effective mass would be very close to the mass of a hydrogen atom. This kind of makes sense, because if you think about an HI molecule vibrating, it really does approximate a hydrogen atom vibrating against a wall, because the iodine atom is so much more massive. That's all for now. We'll spend some more time in class working through some of the math associated with the harmonic oscillator, but in the next video, we'll move on to rotational motion.